What up? You're listening to the True Conversation Podcast, presented by Volcom. I'm your host, Fat Tony. For this episode of True Conversation, our guests, Tion Torrance, aka Bukue One, Black Dave, and Murs, discuss the connections between skateboarding and hip-hop. These two subcultures may have taken a while to link up, but the bond they formed made an indelible impression in pop culture. So this is True Conversation, Volcom Podcast. Today's episode is about hip-hop and skateboarding. We have the fucking greatest rapper of all time, Murs. We have the illest man in New York City, Black Dave. And we have Tion Torrance, a.k.a. Bukue One, representing the Bay Area.
Word.
What's happening, y'all?
Let's get it.
So just to kick it off, I want to ask y'all, how did y'all get into skateboarding in the first place?
All right. Well, I got into skateboarding in 87. And it really was because just there were older kids in my neighborhood on my block who skated. So they bring their jump ramps. I was era of like jump ramps. So they bring a jump ramp in the middle of the street and they'd be skating. And so at that age, when I was 11, you know, you're trying to beat, you know, BMX here and there. You're swinging on, jumping across rooftops. You're just looking for some type of adventure. We saw these cats doing it and it just kind of caught my eye. And, you know, they weren't really about letting the young cats skate with them. We were called skate rats back then. So we had to form our own little collective, like five of us, and then we just started doing the same thing. And then from there, we heard they was going to Embarcadero, you know, in Oakland Tech. And so we just kind of would go there, and then, you know, the rest is history. If you know
famous
about the Bay
spots.
And B, it's like, yeah. You show up there, you're pretty much going to live there unless they chase you out. But we're, you know, luckily we're local cats. We didn't get that out-of-towner welcoming that a lot of cats A&B would get.
Yeah.
Black Day, what about that. You?
I first got into skating. I was about like maybe 10 or 11 years old. And it was kind of the same, similar to what Tion said about in my neighborhood. It was just kids in my neighborhood that was kind of doing everything, biking, skateboarding. And, you know, I saw it as something that was just free spirited. Like my family wanted me to do all the sports and try all the like things that you would be introduced to while going to school, like, you know, the soccer, basketball, all that shit. But skateboarding was something that I saw and just kind of, you know, I just fell in love with the music that was involved with it, the art, the style behind it. And I just, you know, just like that, like stuck with it from jump. New York City was different too. So it was something that just, you know, kept evolving.
Yeah, New York is a trip, bro. I figured out, I'm like, how y'all niggas skate in the winter? I was like, they're like, we don't really unless we're indoors. Like we took it for granted. You know what I'm saying? We could just all day. But yeah, for me, I guess it was probably TV thrashing or some shit that I saw. And then I made my parents buy me a Big Five, like Heat Zone skateboard. My brother had a Veriflex. And then from there, it's just like at the grocery store, I was like, what's that? That's, I'm about that magazine. I looked in there and I was like, oh, it's cheap skates. You know what I'm saying? I was like, I need this. And then having black parents, they were like, I ain't about to spend $100 on some shit for you to break your neck, nigga. You ain't got the dollars. You know what I mean? I was like, yeah. But it's a Santa Cruz with independent. I needed a Santa Cruz board with independent trucks and OJ2s, like Swiss berries. Like, I knew the whole shit. Like, because that's how my mind works. Like, I'm obsessed about that shit. And so I took out the trash and I was one of the only kid I know that had to pay half for his Christmas present because they're like, we spent $50 on skate.
Oh, wow.
You don't give a
fuck. I ain't never heard that.
Like, cool, I'll come up with the other 50. And I got a Spidey Santa Cruz deck with the blue and black grip, blue OJ2s. Like, it was everything I ever wanted.
Wow.
Wow.
It's still like, you know, but I can see it. But that, and that's how I got into it from there. It just, you know, H Street, I was in Linwood, so H Street was there. So there was some skaters around, you know what I mean?
That's beautiful.
So, it's just like, yeah, you found motherfuckers, man. You know, that's how you make friends.
Yeah. Yep. So are y'all getting into music and into skateboarding around the same time, or did music come first?
I was all skateboard. Skateboard and then graffiti. Like, music didn't come till I was already through being sponsored and kind of veering more into graffiti and trying to figure out what I was going to do as, like, a young adult, like 18 or 19. So I was all skateboarding and graffiti.
I fell in love with the music too, but music was a part of everything that I was involved with, you know, just always like music was always a part of it. Not so much on the creating aspect, but just being a fan of it and like you know, being into skating, those skate videos had a lot of different music, like classic rock and just reggae, all types of music that I'm being put onto. And like, I'm looking up discographies, all that shit, getting in tune with it.
Music first.
Yeah. I mean, definitely for me, I was into music first, but through skateboarding, I got into way more music from like skate videos like Chomp on This, Welcome to Hell, Girl Video, from like that. And from the Tony Hawk games, I heard about so many, not only rock artists, punk artists, but a lot of rappers too. Like, I think the first time I ever heard of Dale was from the Tony Hawk game. It's kind of interesting how those worlds mix up, you know what I mean? Do y'all remember a time where y'all first saw like a hip hop crew or a rapper start to represent skating?
I mean, for me, like, I'm older, so I was like, we were waiting. I didn't see a skate video until like Future Primitive, I heard about, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Bones Brigade. But when Animal Chin dropped, it was the first time it was like something dropped. Like, we were at, I don't know how, who had it. Somebody had one VHS. I think we were at my homie Tomas's house, and we went to Tomas's house and we all watched it. And when Tommy Guerrero started rapping, we didn't know that, because it was a white boy thing to us. Like, we didn't know they knew what rap was. Mm. So when Tommy Guerrero started rapping in Animal Chin and like freestyle, I was like, yo, like, it was like,
yeah,
it was like our word. I was like, these word worlds meet. And I think that was the first time I know of skate rapping being in a skateboard video. Mm. And I was like, yo, like, and for me, even, because this is before Vanilla Ice, this is the first time me seeing somebody non-black rap, because there was a black in the Bones Brigade. You know what I mean? Like, seeing, well, no, you know what? I take that back. They had Gorgeous Ladies of Wrestling, and those ladies were rap. But other than that, like, you know, like, that was it. And I was like, yo, they could be skating and rapping.
Damn. I kind of feel like growing up, you know, I was really coming out of middle school, going into high school in the early 2000s. So all of my friends, the same time that we're coming up trying to rap, were into skateboarding too. Like, even parts of my crew who were like rappers, they would look at us who were into the skate thing and then try to be like this. Like I'll never forget, my homeboy Keith called me this one day, lying to us about how he went to the skate park and how he like finally landed a kickflip and he fought this dude. And me and my friend Redmond knew that he was fronting, because we go to that park regularly and we never see him there. But it was kind of like, you know, for like part of my crew, getting into skateboarding was a big sense of pride, as much as we wanted to be rappers. Like, there was never sense of like, oh, the skater's here, the rapper's here. And also, I grew up only pretty much around black dudes till I went to high school. And when I went to high school, the white boys in my school were not fucking with skateboarding. Like, it was only us. They were on some other shit.
Wow.
That's a fact. It was like that. I remember my first time really seeing rappers that were in my area link up with skating was Zoo York, the EST videos and the mixtape videos. They had Wu-Tang in there. They had Big Pun in there. They had all these legends. Busta Rhymes did a track for that. It was like really, really early on. It was in the studio with Stretch and Bobbito. Yeah, Stretch Armstrong, Stretch and Bobbito did the show, and these rappers would get up with them, and RB and Molly would go and film it. And that shit was just some raw, like, original videos, too. It wasn't like they had bought the song off them. They was making these raw tracks. So I still go back to those videos and get reminded of, like, the fucking raw golden era shit, you know what I'm saying? Like that real East Coast, like.
Do you think that was like more of an East Coast thing, or were skate companies across the country all fucking with hip hop?
I think that video in particular was definitely more of an East Coast thing, just because of the choice of artists that they had, and, you know, it was all New York City skating, all tri-state area skating. But that was global. Like, that shit was like the shot heard around the world. That shit went global. Like, they ate it up all over.
Yeah, real. You know, growing up skateboarding in Oakland, and I started like probably right after Murs. So I started, my first video I saw was Search for Animal Chin. It was like 87. There was no intersection between hip hop and skateboarding in my world, other than us, because we were bumping, you know, NWA and AMG and hip hop and, you know, Bay Area hip hop in 87, 88, 89. while we're skating, but at the same time we're bumping Primus and DRI and Bad Religion, yeah, and Dinosaur Jr., because that's what's in the videos.
Yeah.
So we had, the soundtrack was dual, you know, it'd be like, you know, Coog Nut 415 and like, you know, Primus. And then we just flip them in and out. And it wasn't until, you know, early, like you saw 89, there was a couple little hip hop trickles in some videos, but like 90 is when it really started to tip in the skate videos. And of course, like H Street started having a little bit. And then by the time Plan B hit with Questionable, it was full tilt. And then everything, like skateboarding just shifted. The soundtrack, as skateboarding made that shift from primarily, you know, ramps and stuff, as it made that shift in the primarily street, all of a sudden the urban style, the soundtrack and everything became a part of it. And so when street skating kicked in, all of a sudden the soundtrack and the way that we looked in New York and Brooklyn and Newark and in Fillmore and in Oakland, all of a sudden we became what a skateboarder looked like. Because back then, like back when we started, me and Murs started skating, like there was no intersection. Like skaters were not trying to be like hip hoppers, and hip hop cats were not. And like, you know, in my area, like in the hood, it wasn't Berkeley. You know, they would make fun of me, and I'd have to, when they try to break me from my board, I'd be like, "Yo, you're gonna mess up your shoes," and they'd be like, "Oh shit," and they'd give me my board back.
Yeah,
that's a quick way to defuse any fight back in the day.
Yo, look at my shoes, son. You don't want to fuck up your Elises or your Saucony's or whatever it was.
Who are some of those first rappers that y'all remember hearing getting embraced by, you know, brands and in videos and by skaters and all that?
Murs.
Yeah. it was Hyro without a doubt. Like, yeah, when they put, because I had heard rumors about Taxi Driver and Soul's Always Misbehaving and Mischievous. I can still, Kaboom the Jedi. Somebody bust a cricket grind right when he said, when A Plus says that.
Yeah.
He had heard about that song, and I had some white dudes at my school who were like famous producers, like Ariel Rothschild or whatever, I can't pronounce the Rothschild, and Jesse Shack, who's from Sia and Madonna, U2 now. But they were white dudes at my school that had a music academy, and they're like, "You like Hyro? Have you heard this?" I was like, "That song doesn't exist. I can't find the dub of it." He's like, "It's in the skate video." And they had a homie that lived up the street. I was like, "Take me to his house right now and play that video." And I saw it in the video, and I was like, I thought skating was dead. Like in 88 in LA, crack hit, it was done. We was cripping. It was no more skateboarding. You can meet some crips right now with an ill ass kickflip. But that shit was wartime. Bro, you know what I mean?
Straight up.
So when I got to high school, I was like, "Y'all niggas still skate? And they make videos still?" And I was like, "Yo." I was like, "Take me to your house. I want to see this." And when I saw it, we immediately formed something called Scapper Mob. And we just like skaters, rappers. And we I was like, I bought another skateboard. And I didn't put it down like since, like that was like 91, 92. Cause I never knew that the cultures merged. I had stepped away from it cause the streets in LA got so, and I had moved out to the Valley for a while and there was skating there, but definitely was not skating and rap. Like DJ Quick and, you know.
Yeah, it was different worlds. But
it was like Man This, Public Domain, all those videos, they didn't have a lot of rap in it. I think Peralta, whatever his fucking name is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
whatever. But it's funny, he did a gangbanging documentary later, but they weren't putting no rap in their videos.
Mm.
And then
bro,
when the Baycast got on it, it was on.
Yeah, and so to add to that, because I'm working on this documentary before COVID, which is Master the Ollie, which is the skateboard hip-hop love story. So I've been really delving into origins. Wow. So one of the first people I interviewed was Kent from FTC. Mm. And so what happened was, he was saying that, you know, Javonte Turner and Dell were good friends and they'd hang out at the skate shop all the time. So Javonte had all this Dell and Hyro music.
Oh, it was him.
And so Javonte via FTC and Carol was around all that. So when they put in their video parts, like, which is Plan B Questionable, like they had all this unreleased Dell Hyro stuff. And so the Plan B Questionable video is so important because it had like six songs that were hip hop, maybe six or seven. Two of them were Hyro. There was Della 1212 and there was Burnt. And then Fushnikin's Lost Move and like Naughty by Nature OPP. But that video was so, that was the video where it's like skateboarding back and it's street skating. And that's literally this new epicenter of what is now skateboarding. And so that soundtrack being a part of that video with those MCs So Dell and Hyro were forevermore, unbeknownst to them, which is a funny thing, is none of them skated. They didn't even know that it was happening. The groundswell wasn't happening until later on when they would just do shows and be invited to ASR trade shows and stuff. And all of a sudden, there's seeing like skaters and snowboarders in their fan base, and they didn't know why it was happening.
So all this is really happening without label involvement, any of that. Yeah. It is all just naturally happening because the artist happens to fuck with people who are in the skateboard world.
Yeah, skateboarding is a subculture, which is so dope, is that no matter how big it got, it still operated like a subculture and probably would have never accepted any music from a label trying to hand them some new artist trying to get on a skate video.
Right. Mm. Right.
Man, you mentioned Murs as like one of the first that you heard. Murs, I remember first hearing about you from an ad in the back of Thrasher magazine. Was there a point in your life where you started to try to put skateboarding more into your music? Yeah. Or you started to see more skaters coming to your shows or what?
I was just that kid. Like, I was the video after Questionable, Buku?
The video after Questionable and Plan B was Virtual Reality.
Reality. From Virtual Reality, when I said that, told that kid, I think it was Eugene. I was like, Eugene, we got to go to your house. I never stopped skating. And I was already I was selling weed and getting records from Capitol and stuff. So they were in the Beastie Boys still. I didn't know Beastie Boys still made music. So we would go to the courthouse where like Kareem and all these dudes would show up, and I would slang promos just like the pros would come up and slang their decks and stuff, their flow shit. And I was selling weed and shit and just hanging out and you know, being a poser, because I couldn't do no fucking tricks. I hadn't skated in, you know, so long. But then when I went to the Bay, I was like, this is where it's happening, you know? But we were in East Oakland, and I remember we took the train to EMB, and I didn't know what vibing was. But, like, you know, we were trying to skate, and I was, you know, like, just a little 50-50 and, you know, off, you know what I mean? Nothing big, and they were, like, vibing me, like, but giving me mad dog and shit. I was like, I'll fuck these white boys up, cuz. Like, what the fuck is this? Like, you know, in L.A., there's no such thing as, a tough white kid, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I just got my skateboard, and my homie's like, chill, chill. And he's like, let's just go. So I got back, and then they're like, oh, were they vibing you? I was like, the fuck does that mean, man? But they weren't, I went to FTC, and they act like they didn't care about Living Legends. They didn't know about shit. So I was like, you know what, fuck FTC, fuck EMB, fuck all that shit I heard about. And, but I still, you know, there was the only place, like, I remember when the Sheep Shoes dropped, it was the only place for me to go to get shit. But I never stopped skating. Me and Aesop would skate in the outhouse. We lived in a warehouse. We would skate. We were the only niggas skating East. And then homie Jamie, who has Occupy Skateboards now.
Jamie Hustle. Yep.
And, you know, but it wasn't still, it wasn't popping. Then when I moved back to LA and I had some money, I moved to Orange County. I got an apartment in Orange County, and I ran into pro skaters, and I was like, oh shit. And then they just gave me it again. We talked about it, Tony. It's like, I was like, I met James Craig, and he had a machine for his knee. He hurt his knee and blind paid for this machine for his knee. I was like, how many contests were you winning, bro? He's like, what? I was like, he's telling me how much he got paid a month. I was like, so how many contests do you have to win to get that? He's like, nah, I'm just on the team. I was like, what the fuck do you mean? And he's sending me photo incentive. He's like, I get paid from independent this much a month. I get paid this much from my grip tape company, this much from my deck company, this much from my shoe company. I was like, yo. And then my wheel company pays this. And then if I'm in an ad for Blind, I'm wearing an independent t-shirt, I get photo incentive. I was like, yo. But then if I do a feature in the same magazine, I was like, and I remember, but I just started kicking with Gershon and all these dudes. So when songs would come up, they're like, I need a song. Like, here's this, like you said with Javante and Dale, was just like, here's a song. When Tony Hawk came around, the people who were in the scene know that I'm around, so my name just, you know. But on a business level, I came at LRG, I was like, yo. I went to their office one day and I saw what they were paying Carl Watson and all their skaters. I was like, yo, how come Living Legends don't get that? How come we don't get a monthly stipend? And the dude, you know, rest in peace, he told me, like, we don't pay rap. And I was like, fuck you mean?
You know, why is that? Why was there a divide between what we would pay skaters
up to pay dues? Pay they wanted to sponsor pay dues.
Clothing company.
I went into LRG. I was like, this is the 2000s. I'm like, yo, y'all still ain't paying rappers? I was like, y'all got Casey Veggies. Y'all ain't paying him? I was like, y'all can't sponsor pay dues until you start to pay some of these rappers, just like you pay your skaters.
Right.
But it comes into, and since I'm the only white person is in the bottom right, but he's not. it comes down to like niggas being niggas, man. You know, they're like, we'll pay such and such every month, and then he'll be on TV wearing Versace. You know what I mean? But you pass it, yeah. And they will do it. And I was like, all right, like I can't really argue with you there.
Yeah. You know, because that's like Murs, what you're talking about. And you know, because I've managed Dell for a decade, and my whole focus was what you just said with the James Craig thing. When you started seeing how skaters got paid, like I started managing Dell right when the Napster shit really hit. And so I saw his sales dip and I saw his tour attendance dip too. And I was like, well, shit, I'm a skater. Let's go back to the skate industry. I know they rally around you. So I said, let me turn Dell into a pro skater, an endorsed athlete. And his athletics were Sonic. He was a Sonic athlete. And so my first thing is I had a very hard time going to these brands who would always be giving us hella shit. And I'd be like, well, how about we just get the monthly retainer? We get this and that. And they were just like, they were exactly what Murs was saying. And what I found out is, one, it was completely foreign to them. But the other one is rappers to them don't stay on brand message. They just get hella free shit and they just hoard it. They get it from everybody. And mm-hmm. they saw how rappers just be like, give me free shit. And then so what happened, it soiled the relationship. So when a Murs and a Living Legends came along on some real like, yo, we'll actually do this, they were like, yeah, okay. And that really, really soiled the whole relationship. So it took us a while to convince brands that Dell would stay on message, because me as a manager who skates and is hip hop, I'm gonna make sure that when Dell, if we're sponsored by Arnett, although Dell likes to rock big, you know, Bootsy Collins funk glasses, I'm gonna be like, yo, pick some Arnett's that you like, and I'm gonna have a backpack full of them. So when you go on stage and you're rocking in boots, I'll be like, yo, here, remember this? Remember we talked about? Oh yeah, my bad. And then he'll be on stage with shit. So the whole thing was, so like the whole secret between me and Dell when it came to that type of stuff was like this. If you ever look at any photo or any video of me and Dell on stage when I'm backing him up, I'm always wearing his brand. He's always wearing the brand that we're working with. It was my responsibility to do that.
Bars.
Dave, for like you as a rapper and as a skater on like the business side, did you have companies coming to you as a skater first or as a rapper first? How did that all work for you?
I would say it definitely switched up a little bit. Like once music started moving, there was definitely a lot more opportunities to do different shit with companies other than just like putting out some skate footage with them. It was other opportunities. They wanted more like personality type shit. So that was actually something that I wasn't really expecting, but you know, I understood it and I was happy about it, being able to speak more of my message with branding because of them looking at my music instead of just saying, all right, he can skate, he's good at skating, he's actually saying this and that, so let's get him up here and like do some more with him. And you'll see that, but you'll also see a lot of brands out there try to like hoard rap and stuff, like try to really like kind of sell it out and do it like a real fake way and unorganic way, and like that's kind of very, you know, you can see that and you can tell when it's the other way. So you know, it's not always good, but you know, some people do get it and do it the right way for sure.
Do y'all think that this like meshing of these skate companies working with rappers, do you think that's still going on now, or is that just for a time period of the 90s, the early 2000s? Like, tell me more about that.
I think just because the communities are so closely bonded together and have kind of grew together, it will always be something that is integrated and shared, skateboarding and rapping, you know, for sure. I think that we'll just start to see more like business ventures with it, subcategories of it, but it's just going to expand now. Because now a lot more skaters are openly trying to make music and put it out and not feeling it like, oh, I don't know if I want to put out music. They might look at me weird. You're seeing a lot more skaters put out music.
I feel like my generation kind of, we went over the bumps, and Dave and like Tyler and a lot of these kids are, you know, it's not a mesh anymore. It's just who they are. You know what I mean? Like you were saying, like it's just around. It's always, for me, it was like when I did my song Transitions as a writer, motherfuckers were like, the beat is made out of skateboard sounds, the beats made by somebody I used to work at my local skate shop, and motherfuckers were like, what? When like we saw that ad, like I had to explain the LP, like, we're gonna spend money, I don't want a double XL ad, I want a Thrasher ad. You know what I mean? Like, now you don't have to explain it. It just is what it is. And people who can skate can rap, people who can rap can skate. It's just like hooping is for hip hop. There's finally a lane where niggas just accept it. Like, it's just something that we do, you know. But for me, it was like, even just music in general, like Ray Barbie and Tommy Guerrero are excellent musicians. You know what I mean? Like, they could play, you know, Chuck Treese could play, you know what I mean? But I think it was like a thing where the musicians, you can only be a master of one thing. You can't be a skater and a, you know, a musician, whether you're a rapper or not. And you can't be a rapper and a good skater. And that, like, even in my generation, like, I suck. You know, I'm a skateboard fan. I'm more of a poser. Like, I can't, I got Ollie, you know what I mean? Shit, and I can drop in on a foot ramp. Like, I drop in an 8-foot ramp, you know what I mean? Especially with niggas. Niggas are like, whoa.
They get big. Oh, man.
You know, but other than that, I can't do shit. This nigga Fashion is ill. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, Hobson is ill. Like, you know, like,
I feel like. Who are the illest rappers that actually skate that y'all know of?
Wait, hold up. I want to add on to what he was saying. With it. So the cool thing is we got two generations of skateboarder hip hop stuff right here, right? Mm-hmm. Me and Murs came from the era where that shit was not integrated and it was very, very different. What you guys experience now is skateboarding and hip hop is just pop culture now. It's in everybody's vernacular. Right. Back then, when you get clowned as an underground rapper, you know what I'm saying? Back then you get clowned as a skater. Now it's like, you know, like back then, you know, when it was merging, us skaters started, you know, we were already hip hop dressing because we grew up in the hood, so our clothes were already baggy. Skaters came to hip hop and learned about their fashion. Now rappers go to skaters to look at their fashion. It's gone full circle and back around, and it's fascinating. So there'll always be this intersection just intrinsically now because the roots have already grown into a forest. But what I would say is, I think skaters should learn a little bit about hustle from rappers, especially independent rappers, and rappers should learn about how pro skaters get their money structured. And if they get that part, then it's really cracking because I've been around some pro skaters who are like, man, I'm about to quit and focus on my rap. And I'm like, bruh, you should keep that skate pro money and put your CD in your skate deck. Don't leave that. That's secure money. It looks cool over here, but trust me, you want that as your foundation and you can travel on your skate tours and do all your promo and shows you want. Don't leave that.
Right. You know? Everybody got to get on their multiple revenue streams. You feel
me? Oh, yeah. That's a fact. Yeah. That's and if you're getting passive residual from five different brands and you want to give that up to pursue a rap career, I'm like, yo, we'll trade you. Like, I was trying to get up. Like, I'm going to, like, man, we trying to do that. Dale and I are like, we trying to be pro writers for Plan B right now, but we trying to get that Dale, Hyro, you know, all that shit. But okay.
I love my time at Warner Brothers, and Hurley was so excellent to me, bro. Like, I got to meet Jay Adams, which is on top, but I got to meet the CEO, and they'd be like, you want to come surf? And nobody wore suits. They were part of their culture. Like, that's the thing about action sports is it's usually authentic. I would show up on, I'd drive down there on a weekday, and I'm like, where's everybody at? Oh, you know, Waves is popping. It's, you know, I'm like, see, I just left work. And that, like, the record industry needs to be more like that, where it's just a bunch of people that look like us and like, oh, you know what? Pharrell just made a dope beat. We all down in the studio listening to that shit.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
I feel that.
Yeah, I think that's the vibe to get the best work done.
I feel like kids is the fucking thing that merged us all together because hip-hop comes from New York.
Talking about the movie skating. Kids.
Yeah, when that movie came out and it was like New York skaters and New York hip-hop, that's when I feel like the real seed is what's happening now. Because you can't have the Mecca of hip-hop not involved with something, you know? Once skateboard got ordained by the Mecca of hip-hop, then hip hop became like, okay, it's cool to stay. And rightfully so, you know?
What do y'all think about that shift from when you started to see the mainstream pop culture embrace rap and embrace skating, and you started to see big artists like Lil Wayne, Tyler, Lupe, all talking about skateboarding openly in their music, in their videos, and all of that?
Man, I think it's great. Just because the bigger, the higher the tip of the pyramid goes, the wider and bigger the base gets. So people like Murs and people like me who are managing artists who are trying to really build an intersection, it made it easier for me to pitch what I'm talking about when it's so apparent now. After the first 3 or 4 years of me trying to turn Dell into a Sonic athlete, I didn't have to pitch it no more. Their brands were coming to me partially because with social media rising, skate videos became somewhat past that. You needed clips. You needed like 30 clips a month for a company to really sustain. And you couldn't get music at that rate by the typical way of trying to just use it in the old school skate where you just grab a clip and put in your video and just go. The algorithms were kicking in. YouTube was kicking in, kicking people off. So I'm like, yo, you get us on, we'll give you unlimited music from us and our peers. So they were looking for us because they needed more music and we needed more marketing exposure. So the sales pitch was not a pitch anymore. It was just a natural conversation. Like we need to work together because, and it was, you know, where earlier it was like trying to explain to somebody something that was coming, but they didn't see it yet. Now, but by the time Lil Wayne's and Luke, by the time Kick Push came out, it was already in vernacular. Like these subcultures were no longer subcultures. They were dictating pop culture, you know?
Man, it's fucking incredible to hear the history of it and to see the present of it. Like, it's like, I don't know, like coming up for me as like a young kid, rap music and skateboarding were the coolest things in the whole fucking world. But I had no idea that there was a past where they were separate or that wasn't the case. You know, like I can't imagine a time in my life where I didn't know about the two. You know, and I'm kind of curious to see where it goes from here. Like, is it going to come to a point where those things might become passe to kids or what?
I mean, I got a 7-year-old, a 2-year-old, and a 1-year-old. And we got a Paw Patrol board this big. They got that, like, nine-incher wider, you know what I mean?
Wow.
With the super soft wheels. They got a cheap, you know, skateboarder, like, you know, Speed Demons. We got a skateboard board. That shit ain't going. And these kids love it, man. I put Animal Chin. I put on new skate videos. They're like, you know, I think it's something that's amazing, you know, about it to them. And for me, I just geek out on the fact, like, this will be normal to you. You know what I mean?
It's crazy. Well, man, I appreciate y'all talking to me and, like, everything that y'all have done to, like, contribute to both of these cultures becoming one. It's fucking awesome. Thanks, y'all.
That's all good. And the origin story of this relation, like, my documentary is about this. Like, when you're saying you didn't even really know that there was ever time to separate, it got me excited because that's part of why I wanted to do this documentary, like, you know, Master the Ollie, a skateboarding hip-hop love story. Because when you go back to the origins and you watch these cultures parallel, they both have so many parallels that's crazy. They both started around the 70s and really took wind about the early mid-80s. Then a big shift started happening around 87, 88. And then the golden era of both of them, kind of like 88 to like 95 for both of them, was where it went from like this subculture to where, like, if you heard some hip hop, that was your friend no matter who they were. You're like, oh shit, you listen to hip hop? When you heard that board rolling down the street in 87, 80, you out there looking for, like, who was that? And then they both just came and it just, this perfect storm. And it's such a beautiful origin story. And there's so many of us that have been affected by it. So it's real. I appreciate this platform. This is exactly what it is, you know?
Dude, I'm looking forward to that documentary, man. It's going to be great to see it explained in a beautiful way like that. Because I completely agree. Like, you see a lot of the DIY stuff with skating and similar with music. You know, it's just people with their own, doing it in their crib, keeping the shit raw. It's like, that's the stuff I fell in love with skateboarding and music.
I never thought about it. You said I never knew the term DIY till I got into skateboarding. But, like, I think now even a lot of rappers, like, can't engineer themselves. Like, being a skater, like, I had to put my deck together. I had to know how to change it. So I'm in the habit of, like, if I do something and it's my passion, I got to know how to record myself, make a tape, make a CD, you know, upload. Like, I got to know all of that. I think that comes from skating.
Right.
Yeah. And that's the thing with Murs. I just want to give you and the legends props because I've seen it from a fan and then I work side by side with you on tours and shows and stuff. You've always been super DIY. Like, we'd be out, you know, at venues and Murs wouldn't even have a show that night. He'd be out there slanging his tapes, just hanging out in the front. Like, super down to earth. And Living Legends kind of always had that blue collar DIY ethic from the first minute I heard a tape. And that is something that is so intrinsic to skateboarding, which is not as much in hip hop, but you guys had that, like, you guys had that same grit, that same attitude of like, we're just gonna do it how we do it. We're just gonna do it. We're not gonna wait. We're not gonna shop it. We're just gonna make it and do it. And that right there is you know, it's so Bay, but it's also so skate that, you know.
Like, that's, I think, I remember seeing Jason Dill's part, was it in like one of the Alien videos where he was in New York skating? I was like, this nigga's in the middle of the street just getting it. Like, like, that was, even though I was developing as, that was inspiring to me. Like, that's why I love surfing skate videos, because you just get your shit and you go and make it happen. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, I love it, man.
Got to get it no matter what.
But yeah, man, I'll take time, like, do all black men on here. I want to honor Keenan Milton and Harold Hunter.
R.I.P.
That no longer with. Man, in this culture, I'm just glad it merged, man. You like, you know, it's just, I don't ever see it not being one.
Even though I never got deep into it as a actual skater, but like more as a fan, I don't think that I'd be the artist I am today without skateboarding.
That's a fact. I agree, man. Yeah. Completely agree.
There's nothing like the energy and the massive creativity and progression of a skateboarder.
I was thinking now, just like the tattoos on the face and stuff. First person I seen with like that was like before rappers, like Jay Adams had it, you know what I mean? Like, it looked like I got my ribs tattooed because I saw Bam had it done, like before I saw Tupac had tattoos, but it wasn't like a lot of rappers have punk rock tattoos now, which to me comes from skate culture. Like Wayne made face tattoos what they are, and he's a skater, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
Whether he got it from watching that or just the energy of it, you know what I mean? Like hardcore punks look like Post Malone, look like, you know what I mean?
Right.
At the time when there was two, man.
We all part of the same family tree. It's crazy.
Yeah, man, it's wild, dude. Now, Buku got me feeling old now. I'm thinking back, like, wow, I used to really be, I take it for granted. So,
when we get around our future rockers right here who are like the pillars of the torch right now, and we're like, and they're talking about us like OGs and shit. I'm like, oh yeah, that, I guess, if, yeah. Damn, it's 2020, bud. It's almost 40 years removed from 86, 87. Like, it's, yeah, I mean, I remember how old I am when I have to roll out my knees before I skate and then roll them out midway through skating so I can finish trying to land that trick and then roll out my knees some more. You know, my son's 18 now and he's killing it. Wow. So I'm like, fools be like, how long you been skating? I'm like, man, since I was 11. Like, how old are you? I'm like 43. They're like, and it's just this whole big this thing. So yeah, you an OG, Murs. You an OG. You for sure, you OG.
Old guy, man.
You got the whispers mustache and shit. You OG.
Oh,
you
got shit. It.
You got it. You got it good.
Well, man, I can't thank y'all enough, man. Peace to all y'all for rocking with us. This is True Conversation. Volcom, Fat Tony, Murs, Tion Torrance, Black Dave. We out of here.
Peace, y'all.
Peace.
Peace.
All right.
Thanks for tuning in to the True Conversation podcast, presented by Volcom. Volcom would like to offer you a 15% discount at Volcom.com. Just enter code podcast at checkout and a discount will be applied. Peace.
Walked in the store with 20 for the slots. Left with a dollar and a lotto ticket got. Back in the car and went back to the block. Now we in the house cooking up a new plot. First it was stocks.